would like to welcome you to the Oxford College of Pharmacy founded by our esteemed late founder, Chairman Sri S. Narasaraju Garu in the year 1992 to impart quality education in the field of pharmaceutical science. The Honorable Chairman Sri S. N. B. L. Narasimharaju Garu, Director Dr. Mal Murugan and Principal Dr. Padma M. Parakh were instrumental in bringing the overall growth of the institution and the field of pharmaceutical science. The Oxford College of Pharmacy offers various courses like D-Pharm, B-Pharm, M-Pharm in Pharmacognosy, Pharmaceutics and Pharmacology, as well as PharmD and PharmD post-baccalaureate. The Oxford College of Pharmacy has excellent laboratory facilities, an exhaustive collection of books, journals, well-qualified, trained, and experienced teaching staff to impart thorough knowledge. Our Honorable Director, Dr. Mal Murugan, has 30 years of experience in teaching. He is well-qualified from different universities and has also taught in universities in abroad as well. He is very encouraging and inspiring as a person. We all welcome you, sir. Sir, I request our Honorable Director to share some few words.
Very good morning. At the outset, I'm very happy to be part of this webinar, and I welcome our chief guest of this morning, who is going to give a lecture on or webinar on understanding and causes of the varicose veins. Am I audible to you?
Yes, sir.
So Oxford College of Pharmacy is organizing more webinars in this pandemic period on various topics to help both staffs and students of various departments. And this is one such program on a very important topic. And all we know that, right, varicose veins is very common disease nowadays. And it is mainly due to, right, the twisted veins or the improper flow of blood due to various reasons. And some people, they will ignore this problem. There is no pain or there is no, right, discomfortness. And for many people, this is giving, right, more kind of pain and they cannot manage easily. Because of, right, its presence in the leg and foot. So we will understand, right, the problem of this disease, and we should know about its causes. And this program is organized in the right time, though we are in the pandemic situation even now. Though we have crossed the first wave, second wave, we are still expecting the third wave also. Still there is a big fear everywhere in the globe. Including our own right country. And some people, they said that already started. So we should be very, right, very cautious in this period. From other diseases also, though we have, right, the threat from corona. But learning should not be stopped anyway. Though we have so many issues, learning should be stopped, should not be stopped. It should be a continuous process. So, in this line, our Oxford College of Pharmacy is organizing another webinar on this varicose veins. So, this webinar is going to, right, give more the inputs to both staff and students of Oxford College of Pharmacy in this particular area. I also, right, join my hands in welcoming our chief guest. I am also waiting for his the lecture on the topic of understanding causes of, right, chronic vein insufficiency. So I am very much, right, thankful for the opportunity given to me by the organizers to say a few words at the beginning of the webinar. Very all the best for the successful end of this program. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now, I may take time to introduce our beloved principal, Dr. Padma M. Parakh, who inspires us with her dynamic leadership. She is very smart, hardworking, and motivational. We welcome you, ma'am. I request our principal, ma'am, to share some words.
Good
I request all the participants to mute until it is not directed to unmute yourself and ask questions. Please kindly mute yourself.
Hello.
माइक ऑन कैसे?
हेलो, गुड मॉर्निंग. यू आर एबल टू हियर?
यस मैम, यू आर ऑडिबल.
ओके, गुड मॉर्निंग टू वन एंड ऑल. बिहाफ ऑफ आवर काउंटर चेयरमैन श्री एस नसर एंड श्री एस एन बी एल नर्सिंग होम डायरेक्टर मॉन मुर्गन डॉक्टर पार्थसारथी एंड टुडेस चीफ गेस्ट मिस्टर प्रभाकर and other faculty members. Dr. Parthasarathy, other delegates who have joined this program. I welcome you all to this webinar, which is, this varicose vein webinar is not that common, but we thought it is a good thing that people know. Many people suffer from this varicose vein and they have severe problems and pain. So we thought it is an apt the topic to be discussed for this webinar. So we started Dr. Parthasarathy as a all of you and some people we have joined from you. I would like to tell about my college. So Oxford College of Pharmacy was started in the year 1992. We started with the B.Pharm and D.Pharm. Yes, Dr. Malamurugan, sir. Hello. So we have started Yes, sir.
From other microphone, some disturbance is coming.
Okay. Now it is okay, sir?
Yeah, now it is okay, ma'am. Now it is okay.
Ma'am, I request to request you to unmute yourself.
Madam, your voice is not audible.
And you have to give the right to unmute.
Yes.
It's not okay. Specialization, the specialization, pharmacology, pharmacology and pharmacy, pharmaceutics. And then later we added pharmacy. So we have wonderful lab facilities and we have a very exhausting collection of library books. And always our chairman tells that quality only stands. So this is one more feather for our institute to organize one more webinar. In this direction, and in this direction, we take steps to enhance further the quality. And we hope this webinar will be an ever interesting topic for you. Maybe later you take research in this area also. And let us not waste time. Already we are late. Let us give here to Dr. And I give the mic.
Thank you, ma'am. I am happy to introduce our HOD of Department of Pharmacy Practice, Dr. Parthasarathy ji. He is a well-experienced person in teaching for about 18 years. He is very supportive and encouraging. We welcome you, sir. Now, I request our HOD, sir, to share some few words. Sir, I request you to unmute yourself.
Yeah, madam. For this opportunity, good morning, all of you, delegates, friends, faculty members. On behalf of Oxford College of Pharmacy, the chairman, SNL, Narasimha Rao Ji, and our director, sir, Malamurugan, sir, and our principal, madam, Dr. Padma M. Parekh, I take this opportunity to welcome all the delegates who have joined here to listen to my beloved friend, Mr. Prabhakar's speech on the topic varicose vein, understanding the causes and treatment options for varicose vein. I am proudly introducing my friend, Mr. Prabhakar. We have 25 years of friendship. I would like to introduce my friends because he is a very enthusiastic person and also hardworking and a very simple person. He has gained a lot of knowledge in the field of community pharmacy, working tremendously in the Middle East country, gained a lot of knowledge in that. So such a resource person will be really helpful to learn the field of community pharmacy, how the community pharmacies can help public about to create awareness about the diseases like varicose vein. Because the varicose vein is caused because of changes in lifestyle. It is induced because of this lifestyle modifications. And these, if it is found in the early stages, you can find a cure for this problem. Otherwise, it becomes a life threatening. So that the role of community pharmacists is very essential, particularly in our country. This is the time we should understand and develop and strengthen the field of community pharmacy in India. So this is a great opportunity for our students to learn from a person who practicing this in an very developed country in which in the community pharmacy system is very strongly adopted. I welcome Mr. Prabhakar to our college to present today's webinar virtually. Thank you. Thank you for this.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
I myself, Dr. Juvedia Banu, Assistant Professor, the Oxford College of Pharmacy, take this privilege on behalf of Chairman Sri SNBL Narasimha Raju Garu, Director Dr. Mal Murugan, Principal Dr. Padma M. Parak, HODs, staff and students to introduce the guest speaker of the day, P. Prabhakar. Sir has completed B.Pharm from Tamil Nadu, Dr. MGR Medical University, Chennai. An executive post director diploma in business management in Symbiosis Institute of Business Management, Pune. With glorious career spanning, is highly motivated pharmacist for more than 22 years experience gained as community pharmacist as well as the marketing of pharmaceutical products. As community pharmacist, expert in patient counseling for medication administration, drug interaction, etc. As marketing of pharmaceutical product specialist, expert with various pharmaceutical therapeutic management such as oncology, anesthetic, hemostatic agents, immunomodulators, venotonic agents, antibiotics, and hematology segments. Sir has got the Best Pharmacy Practice Award from Ministry of Health, Oman in the year 2008. Committed to continuous medical education and regularly updating knowledge through pharmaceutical related courses. Formerly, Sir has worked as medical representative at Glenmark Pharmaceutical Limited from 1999 to 2004. And as community pharmacist at Muscat Pharmacy in Oman from 2004 to 2011. As medical representative at Waleed Pharmacy, Oman from 2011 to 2013. Sir is honored with the Best Pharmacy Practice Award from Ministry of Health, Oman in the year 2008. And also got the Best Sales Performance Achiever Award in the Glenmark Pharmaceuticals Limited All India Top 10. Sir is currently working with Ibn Sina Pharmacy in Oman as a product specialist for OMVI V4 Pharma products. We all welcome you, sir. Now I would like to hand over this session to our guest speaker. We once again welcome you, sir.
Good morning to one and all. Am I audible? Am I visible?
Yes, sir.
All of you are doing well. Thank you, Ms. Juvedia ma'am, for your galvanized introduction. Your excellent introduction makes me highly enthusiastic and energetic in this morning. At this juncture, I take this opportunity to thank the management of the Oxford College of Pharmacy, Chief Patron and Chairman, Mr. Narasimha Raju, patron and director Dr. Mal Murugan, convener principal Dr. Atma Parak, and organizing secretary Dr. G. Parthasarathi, professor and HOD of pharmacy practice. Thanks to all the faculty members, staffs, and students, and my beloved friends for supporting, for being here to present for the today's online webinar session. I'm really honored and privileged to be part of the speaker for today's session. Today, I'm going to present the understanding the causes and management of chronic venous insufficiency, which is varicose vein. Next slide, ma'am. You can move to, yes. Why I have chosen this topic? Mainly, for the past 16 months, we are all are suffering from COVID-19 lockdown. We could not move out of home here and there like before. It's like sedentary lifestyle. Whatever the works earlier we did, everything it has changed, and we are working from home. We are attending online meeting, as well as we are just sitting in one place. We are conducting the online classes to the students. Because of this non-movement, our complete health system has been changed, particularly metabolism, as well as that blood flow, particularly in the lower extremities, because we are sitting in the one position and we are conducting the classes and attending all the meeting. Due to this sedentary lifestyle, which has made a lot of physiological challenges. Move to the next slide, ma'am. Yeah, next. The effect of sedentarism affects chronic disease. The prolonged standing or sitting at work, which will increase the risk of developing chronic venous disease. The risk factor for the venous symptoms were varicose vein, which is due to prolonged sitting or standing. Next slide, ma'am. Now, we are going to discuss about the what is chronic venous insufficiency or disease, clinical presentation and treatment, burden, summary. What is chronic venous insufficiency? It's in simple term. Chronic venous insufficiency is a condition caused by weak, worn, or damaged vessels in the veins of the legs. Now we are going to talk about that understanding normal venous anatomy and function, macrocirculation versus microcirculation, introduction to the chronic venous disease and CVI, predisposing factors and complications. Next one, ma'am. So understanding the normal venous anatomy and function. The vascular system is consists of systemic as well as pulmonary circulation. The main function of the systemic and pulmonary circulation is which carry blood to and from all parts of the body through blood vessels. The blood vessels consist of arteries, veins, and capillaries. Arteries, which carries the blood from the heart to tissues and other organs, whereas veins, which carries blood towards the heart. The capillaries is the smallest bodies in the blood vessels. The diameter of the capillary is around 8 to 10 micrometer. Next one, ma'am. Understanding the normal venous anatomy and function. Venous anatomy, you can see the picture, the femoral vein. It's a deep vein, as well as in the large saphenous vein, which is the superficial vein. Below that, it's a perforating vein. And below the segment of the femoral vein, you can see the muscle, which is called calf muscle. This is the main part. Whenever the patient is suffering from chronic venous insufficiency, that calf muscle will make more pain and swelling, and itching numbness may happen. Normal venous blood flow will be, the veins are divided into deep veins and superficial veins. This deep veins. Deep veins are the ones that are closer to the core of your body, sitting in the muscles and alongside the bones. deep veins are most often paired with the arteries in the same area. Superficial veins are important physiologically for cooling of the body. When the body is too hot, the body shunts blood from the deep veins to the superficial vein to facilitate heat transfer to the surroundings. The superficial veins can be seen under the skin, whereas the superficial vessels are responsible for carrying the blood from the tissues closer to the skin surface to deeper veins. You can see that wall, that a 90 deep vein, it's an upward position because that blood will pump towards the heart. And superficial vein, you can see that right side, it's a 10%. Later, the deep veins push the blood back towards the heart. Whereas superficial veins drain deoxygenated blood from the skin and subcutaneous tissue and deliver it into the deep venous system via perforating veins. You can see the below small saphenous vein, that perforating veins or other venous injuries. You can move to the next slide, ma'am. The venous system is consist of veins. As we seen before the previous slide, veins carry blood to the heart. In the normal healthy individuals, blood is pumped out the legs by calf muscle action. You can see the right side, the picture, contracted skeletal muscle and relaxed skeletal muscle. The venous walls determine the direction of blood flow to the heart and prevent the blood from flowing back. The vein wall is very elastic. You can see that right side, that relaxed skeletal muscle, that picture, whereas the contracted one is, which is very contracted muscle. The vein is very elastic and but doesn't contain many muscle fiber. The blood rises when you walk, discharge by squeezing the arc of your foot, and the effect of the muscles on the heart. You can move to the next slide, ma'am. Now we'll see the macro circulation versus micro circulation. There is a venous macro circulation consists of superficial vein and deep vein. Whereas with the venous microcirculation consists of capillaries. The capillaries, as I told you earlier, the diameter of the capillaries is 8 to 10 micrometer. The capillary vessels in microcirculation differ in size and wall structure. Size and smooth muscle thickness increase with the distance from capillaries, while the capillaries themselves have no muscle cells. Can move to the next slide, ma'am.
So you've muted yourself, sir. Prabhakar, sir, can you please unmute yourself?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, now it's okay, ma'am? Yeah.
Yes, sir, it is.
Chronic venous insufficiency, venous disease is characterized by abnormal venous blood flow in the lower extremities, and it is associated with the clinical signs and symptoms such as varicose vein, pain, and swelling. If untreated, chronic venous disease progresses to severe and debilitating conditions such as edema, chronic venous ulceration, and skin fibrosis and recurrent cellulitis. Move to next slide, ma'am. In chronic venous insufficiency. What is chronic venous insufficiency? As I told you earlier, which describes more severe forms of venous disease with symptoms such as pain, swelling, edema, skin fibrosis, recurrent cellulitis, and ulceration. And CVA is associated with a diminished quality of life. Next slide, ma'am. What are the predisposing factors? There are several risk factors have been associated with the development of varicose vein and CVI, such as genetic predisposition, aging, female gender, pregnancy, obesity, smoking, standing occupation, and lack of exercise. These are the several risk factors associated with varicose vein. Next slide, ma'am. What are the complications of chronic venous insufficiency? Untreated venous insufficiency results in gradual loss of cosmesis. What is cosmesis? Which is generally refers to the surgical correction of a disfiguring defect. And persistent pain and discomfort. Hemorrhage means acute loss of blood from a damaged blood vessels. And progressive skin changes that may ultimately lead to ulceration. In rare instances, chronic soft tissue in changes may lead to stiffness of the ankle joint and fixed plantar flexion and periostosis. The thrombobulbitis, what is thrombobulbitis means? You can see the right, that a picture in the human leg. Mainly, it is an inflammatory process that causes a blood clot to form and block one or more veins, which is near the surface of your skin or deep within a muscle, which is called deep vein thrombosis, shortly which is called as DVT. And periostitis means it's the inflammation of the periosteum. It's a layer of connective tissue that surrounds the bone. Next slide, ma'am. The clinical presentation and treatment. We will discuss about clinical presentation of chronic venous disease and CVI, and what is the diagnosis, who will diagnose the chronic venous insufficiency and disease, and what is the treatment and management options for the chronic venous insufficiency. Next slide, ma'am. So these are the different grades of clinical presentation of chronic venous disease according to the clinical signs and disease progression, which has been graded from C0 to C6. If the clinical signs at the grade C0, it is not visible, palpable signs of venous disease, which is, you can see the picture, it's a normal vein. At the stage C0, it is a normal vein. C1, it's a telangiectasis or reticular veins. Just, you can see the picture, some reticular picture like that, which is called reticular veins. And grade C2, this varicose vein, which is distinguished from reticular veins by the diameter of 3 millimeter or more. And even sometimes, if the patient is not following the healthcare professional advice, not taking the proper medication, later it may lead to recurrent varicose vein. And grade C3 is edema of the left leg, mainly. It will first affect that left leg. You can see that swelling edema of the, you can see the normal vein and that edema of the left leg. And grade C4 changes in the skin and subcutaneous secondary to chronic venous disease, which is divided into 3 subclasses to better define the differing severity of the venous disease. C4A, you can see the pigmentation. And C4B, it's a lipidodermatosclerosis. And C4C, which is the latest one, it's a coronoplebectatemia. Because when we are, particularly during this COVID lockdown, as I told you earlier, we are sitting in one position, we are not moving here and there. Because of that, the blood circulation will affect, which is called coronoplebectatemia. And grade C5, the skin changes as defined in the C4, but you can see with the healed venous ulcer, eczema and the healed venous ulcer, we can see. And grade C6, the skin changes as defined in the C4 with active venous ulcer. You can see that active venous ulcer and recurrent active venous ulcers also may happen. The symptoms include mainly, it's an asymptomatic. Mainly the pain and also tightness, skin irritation, heaviness, and muscle cramps, which may happen in the particularly in the calf muscle. Whereas asymptomatic patients also complaining of venous symptoms who doesn't have any clinical signs, anatomic anomalies, or physiological disorders that can be identified by the complementary investigations engaged in the SEEP classification. This is called the SEEP classification. This is based on clinical etiology, anatomic pathophysiology. Based on that, we made it. It's a short form SEEP classification, or assigned to class C0. Next slide, ma'am. Who will diagnose the chronic venous disease and insufficiency? Generally, the patient whoever suffer any pain, first they will approach the family physician or general practitioner. The general practitioner mainly will do the diagnosis of the medical history, family history, clinical examination symptoms description, as well as main proportion of patients is grade C0 to C3. This grade C0 to C3 only the general practitioner will do. Angiologist, they will do the advanced stages of the disease more than grade C3 to C6. And interventional treatment is planned if required. And determine CVA diagnosis with Doppler sonography. You can see that right side, that ultrasound examination of the leg veins by using Doppler sonography. Dermatologists also sometimes they will consult, but which is very rare, involved in the diagnosis and management. Next one, ma'am. The treatment option is, there are two types of treatment option. One is conservative treatment and another one is interventional treatment. The conservative treatment are just, it's a physiological lifestyle changes, raising the legs and regular physical activity. While raising the legs, what it will happen, it will improve the blood flow in your leg veins, which leads to keeping your leg raised, which can reduce the swelling and help increase the blood flow, which leads to, and even we can wear the compression stocking may also help. You can see that compression stocking. This, when you are applying, automatically it will help to reduce the pain and increase the blood flow. And regular exercise can also improve the blood flow. And active venous vein medication, which is called venoactive drugs. These medicines also that increase the blood flow through vessels and may be used along with compression therapy to help heal leg ulcers. Aspirin can also be used to help leg ulcer heal. Medicine that draw excess fluid from the body, such as diuretics, which is excreted through kidneys, are often used, but they may be used if other conditions such as heart failure and or other kidney disease are linked to swelling. Next slide, ma'am. This is the second treatment, is interventional treatment. This is in the advanced stages, the doctor will perform this interventional treatment. The progression of the cutaneous signs of CVI and compression shocking is not possible. The treatment with the interventional thermoablation, chemical ablation, and surgery. Thermoablation means, you can see the right side of the picture, the thermoablation. It's a endovenous laser ablation or radio frequency ablation they may do. This is a minimally invasive procedure. The catheter tube, they will put, it will just in the heat right into the affected vein. You can see that picture. They will just put the catheter tube. It will produce the heat. Then this closes the vein. Once the vein is closed, less blood pools in the legs. Overall blood flow is improved. In the chemical ablation, they may use the sclerotherapy. The sclerotherapy, this may be used if your case is more serious. A chemical is injected. You can see that second picture. A chemical is injected into the affected veins. The chemical causes scarring in the veins so that they can no longer carry blood. Blood then returns to the heart through other veins. The body absorbs the scarred veins. And surgery. This is done in more severe cases. Ligation is a type of surgery that may be used. The affected vein is tied off so that the blood no longer flows through it. If the vein or its walls are heavily damaged, the vein will be removed. This is called vein stripping. Next one, ma'am. This is the treatment and management of chronic venous insufficiency. What are the treatment options? Earlier we discussed the interventional treatment. Now the treatment of venous disease is dependent on the severity of the disease, which is categorized by the, as I told you earlier, SEEP classification system: clinical, etiology, anatomy, and pathophysiology. The treatment goals include reducing discomfort and edema and stabilizing skin appearance, removing painful varicose vein, and healing ulcers. There are two approaches. The first approach is to achieve the correction of superficial venous reflux and venous hypertension, which is we can done by behavioral measure and compression therapy. The behavioral measure, such as physical exercise, elevating the legs to the minimize edema and reducing intra-abdominal pressure, and exercise which improve the calf muscle pump. And weight management, particularly the person is obese, they should do more physical activity to reduce the weight. And compression therapy, when the person is using the compression stocking, it may help to improve the blood flow. And invasive treatment, as we discussed in the earlier slide, endovenous thermal ablation, surgery, and sclerotherapy. And coming to the pharmacological therapy, the approach is to target the underlying pathogenesis pathway in chronic venous insufficiency. The pharmacological therapy, such as venoactive drugs or phlebotonics. There are different drugs available. Earlier, they used benzopyrones and flavonoids. Now, most of the doctors, they are using flavonoids, which is MPFF, which is called micronized purified flavonoid fraction. It's marketly available. The brand is called Daflan. Many of them knows that it can be used for even hemorrhoid and varicose vein also. It's an oral phlebotropic drug, which consisting of 90% micronized diosmine and 10% flavonoids expressed as hesperidin, which improves the venous tone and lymphatic drainage and reduces capillary hyperpermeability by protecting the microcirculation from the inflammatory process. And below that MPFF, the diosmine. Diosmine also is a flavone glycoside of diosmentin, which is manufactured from the citrus fruit peels as a phlebotonic non-prescription dietary supplement used to aid treatment of hemorrhoid as well as chronic venous insufficiency, particularly mainly in the legs. And rutin and rutoside also is there. Rutin, which is called as vitamin P or rutoside, which is widely distributed in the vegetables, fruits, and medicinal herbs such as asparagus and buckwheat. Buckwheat is called Phagopyrum esculentum, which is considered to be one of the best dietary sources of rutin. Eating an apple or figs fruit or drinking a glass of green tea can automatically introduce more protein into your diet. And second drug, which is called Coumarin. Coumarin is a 1,2 benzopyrone, which occurs naturally in tonka beans or cinnamon. It can also be found in the trace amounts of bison grass, green tea, and carrot, even some beers. And next drug is, which is called Assassin and Ruscus extract. The Assassin is a mixture of saponins with anti-inflammatory property, which has got and vasoconstrictor and vasoprotective effect. It's found in the SLS hippocastanum. Assassin is the main active component of horse chestnut and is responsible for most of its medicinal properties. And other plant extracts. The plant extract, which is called Zinco biloba, as well as anthocyanins. Zinco biloba is an herb which contains powerful antioxidants. It can help fight inflammation and improves circulation and heart health. The natural sources of anthocyanins include fruits, flavors, flowers and leaves and roots of plants. The most widely consumed anthocyan natural products include cherries, berries, and cereals. When we come to the synthetic products, the widely used drug currently in the market after the diosmin, that is Daflan brand name, calcium dobicillate molecule, which is available widely all over the world. In India also, the brand name is called Dobicil or Doxium. It's available. Many brands are there. This is a well-known brand, Doxium and Dobicil. It's available in the market. The main active component is calcium dobicillate. CAD is calcium dobicillate, and naftrazone and benzeron. The calcium dobicillate, the main mechanism is it's a venoactive drug to treat the clinical signs of chronic venous insufficiency, which is triggered by venous hypertension in the legs. It has an anti-inflammatory properties and believed to help inhibit the process that lead to leukocyte addition, endothelial dysfunction, and vascular permeability in CVI. Healthy endothelium regulates the platelet aggregation, coagulation, and fibrinolysis and vascular tone. This function impaired in chronic venous insufficiency. What calcium dobicillate will do with this? It promoting nitric oxide synthase activity and inhibiting the endothelin 1. Calcium dobicillate may play a role in restoring the endothelial dependent vasodilation. And also calcium dobicillate has shown to reduce hyperviscosity of the blood and platelet aggregation, improve the blood flow. Vascular endothelial growth factor, which causes vasodilation and increases vascular permeability. This calcium dobicillate, which inhibits the vascular endothelial growth factor expression and downstream pathways, thereby suppressing vascular leakage, helping to maintain the integrity of the microvascular system. Also, calcium dobicillate, which acts on the several biochemical pathways, can in turn affect fluid and lymph flow, reducing edema. When come to the naftrazone and benzeron, these are the drugs, it's a very rarely used, and some of the countries it is already banned due to side effects. Naftrazone is a naphthoquinone derivative, which is indicated in the treatment of varicose vein and superficial thrombophlebitis. And benzeron is a member of 1-benzofurans. It's a non-purine xanthine oxidase inhibitor used for the treatment of gout, but never approved for use in the United States of America due to its serious side effects of acute liver injury and deaths with its usage. Next slide, ma'am. And other drugs also, celecoxib and pentoxifilin, this is a pharmacological therapy. Burden. Next one, ma'am. What are the prevalence of chronic venous disease and chronic venous insufficiency? Chronic venous disease is one of the most commonly reported chronic medical condition, which affects 30 to 84% of adult population. The distribution of the, according to the SIP classification clinical classes, almost 64% of the population affected from the grade C1 to C6. Among that, chronic venous insufficiency, grade C3 to C6 is 24%. 25% of the population affects varicose vein with or without edema, according to the classification of SIP stage C2 to C3, 25% population. And 5% of the population, which affects from grade C4 to C6, the trophic skin changes, including leg ulcers, will affect. Globally, 35% of the prevalence of adult population, particularly class, according to the SIP classification, C2 to C6, is affected. Next slide, ma'am. The health condition of the most patients, finally to come to the summary, the health condition of the most patients with the early stage of chronic venous disease worsen over time. More than half of the general population with chronic venous disease is deteriorating over the time. Next slide, ma'am. The chronic venous disease progression cannot be predicted, but is important to be avoided. Patients with Coronafilipecter tibia have been demonstrated to be 5.3 times more likely to develop an ulcer, a risk of similar magnitude to other C4 skin changes. Next one, ma'am.
Yeah.
So, what is the Coronafilipecter tibia and how it is important in chronic venous disease? Because why I have chosen this topic earlier, I told you, the Coronafilipecter tibia is considered by the many venous authorities as an important early marker progression of chronic venous disease. The Coronafilipecter tibia has been added and classified as the C4 clinical subclasses of the CIP classification in 2020. This Coronafilipecter tibia has been added to CIP classification to take into account the importance of this marker, as there is a statistical association between Coronafilipecter tibia and more advanced stages, and which is defined as a fan-shaped pattern of numerous small intradermal veins and described as the abnormal presence of visible cutaneous blood vessels at the ankle. You can see that picture, that enlarged picture, with four components: venous cuffs, blue and red telangiectasis, capillary stasis spots. It's often a sign of advanced vein disease. What is mean by telangiectasis? Which is a small widened blood vessels on the skin, which is usually harmless but may be associated with several diseases. Next one, ma'am. So to come to the summary, what is the chronic venous disease? As I told you earlier, it's a condition caused by weak bone or damaged walls in the veins of the legs. The symptoms of chronic venous insufficiency is feeling of heavy, tired, and restless legs, swelling of the ankles and calf pain, rash, itching, and cramps. When the itching will happen means, because when the blood flow is affected, automatically that oxygen supply will get stopped. Due to lack of oxygen supply, the lactic acid production may happen, so which makes itching and numbness in that calf muscle region. And some patients, they may get cramps suddenly when they are sitting for a long time. If they are waking up immediately, they could not able to walk, it may make cramps, muscle cramps. And change in skin color later stages, and usually around the ankles. In more advanced cases, veins close to the surface of the skin are swollen, often look blue, bulging, and twisted. We have seen the picture in that classification, CIP classification. In complications of chronic venous insufficiencies, varicose veins are the most frequent complications of CVI. And varicose ulcers can occur upon simply bumping the skin at the level of varicose vein, which leads to wound that is difficult to heal and easily infected. What is the treatment options? As we discussed earlier, symptoms can be initiated in the earlier stages of the disease by compression stocking and venoactive drugs, which is non-invasive medical treatment. In most severe cases of chronic venous insufficiency, we have to go for invasive interventional treatment will be recommended, such as sclerotherapy, laser, and stripping. Preventive measures are change in lifestyle modification, avoid long periods of standing or sitting, begin a walking program, practice sports regularly, keep your legs slightly raised during the night time when you are sleeping, so the blood flow will come towards, so it will, regular blood flow will be there. And particularly the people who are standing long time, particularly the conductor, as well as even the pharmacist who are working as a community pharmacist, and the people whom they are sitting long time, these people, they may affect you a lot. At the end of the day, they may get more pain and swelling will happen. Avoid while sitting, avoid crossing the legs. Avoid wearing tight-fitting clothes, hard-up pants, and prevent excess weight, particularly obese patients, and eat food poor in sugars and fats, but rich in fibers and antioxidants. Protective effect on the brain wall. Drink at least 2 liters of water, which will enhance draining of the tissues. Next one, ma'am. It is important to treat patients at the earliest stages of until the remission of symptoms and edema. This is a consensus, Italian consensus in 2019. They recommended the treatment of patients with chronic venous disease should always include indications and the correct lifestyle to adopt. All the patients in C clinical classes from grade C0 to C3 with symptoms may benefit from treatment with venoactive drugs such as calcium debisilate or MPFF and diosmin. Compressive therapy should be always recommended, particularly in the stages of C0 to C1 in presence of symptoms, while in C2 to C3 regardless their presence. The venoactive therapy should be continued until the remission of symptoms under edema. Minimum treatment period is 2 months should be taken with venoactive drugs. The venoactive drugs should be considered complementary and non-alternative to compression therapy, particularly presence of persistent clinical manifestation of the disease. In the prescription of conservative treatment, the effects of the venoactive drugs on symptoms and on the pathophysiological mechanism of the disease should be considered. Patients needs to be taken into consideration in order to obtain greater compliance with the treatment. Next one, ma'am. These are the scorecards. This is a test you can do at your home itself. Whenever here we can see that they have given the 10 points. Along with that, they have given points 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. For example, do my ankles swell or my shoes tight at the end of the day? You can see if you feel never zero. Nothing. If sometimes if you feel, you can put the score 2. And very often means you can put the score 4 in the last box. Accordingly, you can make it. And do I practice physical activity? If very often means you can put 0. 1. Sometimes means you can put score 1. Never means you can put score 2. Do I have light diet? So accordingly, you can put the things. So at the score level, if it is coming 0 to 8 points, you are the lower risk of chronic venous insufficiency. Check with your doctor about the simple rules of healthy venous lifestyle. Whereas if the points is 9 to 15, moderate risk of venous insufficiency. So please consult your doctor and take the necessity of treatment, which will helps you to reduce further progress. If the points is above 15, 16, it is a higher risk of venous insufficiency. So you should go for the medical treatment, or if it is severe condition, you have to go for the surgery. So this is the small test. We can do it at home itself personally. Next one, ma'am. So these are the few tips that should facilitate blood circulation in the veins. This is a recommended one and non-recommended one. Particularly, you should avoid alcohol, smoking, particularly women. They are wearing the high heel shoes. It should be avoided. And lifting heavy weight and wearing the tight clothes should be avoided. You can do that recommended exercise, cycling, swimming, walking and running, and sports activities you can perform. And these are the simple exercise program on lower limb. Particularly when you are lying down, you can see the first picture. When you are lying on your back, arms along your body, bends your legs to form a straight angle and pedal just 1 minute. in direction and then other direction. Repeat this exercise for 5 times. And we come to the second picture. Lying on the backs, arms along the body, lifting the right leg by drawing the circle bow and then descending of the leg. Doing the same with left leg also. Repeat this exercise for 10 times. And you can sit alternatively, raise the tip of the toe, right foot, then the tip of the left foot, then both at the same time. Repeat this exercise for 10 times. And stand, tip toe up, then slide your feet down. Repeat this exercise 10 times. And sit, roll a ball under the sole of your right foot for 30 seconds, forming circles, and then with left foot. Repeat this exercise for 5 times. So these are the some exercise program for your lower limb. It will improve your blood flow, because particularly now we are at home due to COVID lockdown and we are working remote, working from home, most of the people. So when you are at home, you can do the exercise. Even if you are sitting for a long time, whenever, after every 30 minutes or 45 minutes, you just do this small exercise. It will improve your blood circulation and we can prevent the formation of the chronic venous insufficiency. Not only it will make you more freshness also, and you will be always fit. And try to do walking or running at least 30 minutes a day. It will improve your lifestyle modification. Thank you. You can move, ma'am. These are the references. So if you have any questions, I'm ready to do that. Thank you for your valuable patience, almost 15 minutes.
Thank you, sir. Now I would like to give the opportunity to our participants to ask questions to our speaker.
Hello, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Good afternoon, sir. And the topic, I have a question, sir.
Yeah.
Though varicose vein is a severe condition, but I've seen some, like many people with such kind of veins, sir, which are greenish in color, but they never feel of any pain or swelling and they remain for years, sir. So will that lead to, or is that varicose vein condition, or will that lead to varicose vein, sir?
It may lead to varicose vein. You have to consult with the doctor. The condition is. Can you hear me? Yeah. If the condition is, if they have pain or swelling, any muscle cramps, or if they are feeling some itching or numbness in that particular area, they should consult with the doctor. And those cases, even particularly in the earlier stages when the patient is suffering from varicose vein, at the end of the day, after finishing their work, they can just in the bucket, off of the bucket, they can take warm water, they can put little salt and they can keep the legs inside that bathtub. It will improve the blood circulation. And particularly when you are going to the bed before sleeping, you can just keep your pillow in the legs. You can keep that elevated position, so it will improve the blood circulation. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, sir. And even in like overweight patient or obese patient and all, we can see not greenish color veins and all, sir, but we can see near that behind the knees and all, we can see that like prominent veins, no, sir, which are not greenish in color, but still those veins can be prominently seen, sir. So is that varicose veins or it can lead to varicose veins, sir?
Yeah, we can see that nodules, particularly that veins are the green veins. You can see the nodules like that. It's a twisting. Like that it will be there. So the symptoms, it's a early stages, it may be. But earlier, currently in the early stages they will not feel more pain, but if the symptom is showing like that, well, better they should consult with the doctor. In early stages we can be treated.
Okay, sir. And I have a second question, sir. I come across situations where a patient was having such clinical presentations, sir, such as pain, swelling, and she was suffering a lot, sir. It was a female patient, and yes, doctor prescribed it as a Baker's cyst, sir. So, what is the difference between Baker's cyst and varicose vein, sir? Is both the same or are both different, sir?
Which one, Baker's cyst?
Yeah, sir. Yeah.
Because mainly the women are suffering a lot, particularly varicose vein, 54% of the population, women are suffering a lot. But in Baker's system, I'm not aware of it. But the doctor is recommending means definitely they can continue the treatment. If it is not enough, if it is ineffective means they can go for the other medicinal treatment.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you,
ma'am. I request participants to ask questions.
Mr. Prabhakar, thank you very much for joining us, spending your valuable time based on our request. Actually, I want to ask some general question regarding your community pharmacy experience.
Yes.
You are there in service in Middle East as a community pharmacist. So,
yes,
would you like to share some of your experience with your students? One or two examples.
Yeah. As a community pharmacist, always we should upgrade with the knowledge day to day, what is happening around the world, what are the new drugs are coming. And mainly community pharmacist, the main role is when the patient is coming to you, always you should politely handle the patients, because we don't know the patient reaction. Some patients may be in the happy mode, some patients they may be in the stress mode. So when they are coming to you, first you should discuss with the patient politely what the drug doctor prescribed. Sometimes the prescription when they are bringing, the doctor may prescribe the medication wrongly. For example, the hypertensive patient, the doctor prescribed beta blocker like atenolol drug. The same patients, earlier history of asthmatic. Maybe the patient doesn't convey the message to the doctor, I'm suffering from asthma. Currently, he is taking the salbutamol tablet and doctor also prescribed atenolol. Atenolol is generally a beta 2 blocker, whereas salbutamol is beta 2 agonist. What it will happen, the patient, what they are taking the medication, it will be antagonized the other drug. The purpose of taking bronchodilator, the effect also may reduced, as well as that hypertensive drug, atenolol, also that drug action also reduced. So vice versa. Even sometimes the patient is, the doctor will prescribe, for example, theophylline. Theophylline is mainly for asthmatic patient, the chronic asthmatic patient, the doctor may prescribe. The theophylline has got the narrow therapeutic index. The lethal dose and effective dose 50-50. Particularly when the pediatric patients, the doctor is prescribing, you should counsel to the patient. Whenever you are taking the drug, whatever the doctor prescribed, that same prescribed manner, the dose titration should be maintained. If they exceed little doses extra, it may make untoward effect because of the narrow therapeutic index. And whenever the patient's coming to you, that you have already dispense the medication, for example, diclofenac, painkiller, NSAID recommended to the patient when they are coming to, they are not going to the doctor, they are just coming and meeting you. I'm suffering from pain and you are giving diclofenac tablet. The diclofenac tablet, after taking some patients, if they got allergic, immediately when the patient is returning to you, you should guide them to go and meet the doctors and you should collect the adverse reaction report. Whether he is taking other medications or whatever you have dispensed that particular medication he is taking. After that, you should make follow-up. Patient is okay after consulting with the doctor. Then you should give that information. In future, this drug, if you are taking, for example, some patients also allergic reaction will be there. And if you are going to the doctor and meeting, I'm having that allergic reaction of diclofenac. So in future, don't recommend. In some patients, particularly quinolones, because sickle cell disease, ciprofloxacin. Particularly this Middle East, many people are suffering from sickle cell disease. Those patients, the ciprofloxacin may affect. They will not recommend. And moreover, whenever any CME or whatever the meeting is happening, you should attend and upgrade your knowledge. Same like that, when the patient is coming to you, I'm suffering from cough. If you are recommending, for example, diphenhydramine, in our country, it is available, the Benadryl cough syrup, which contains diphenhydramine. Whenever you are advising to the patient, you should counsel. You should take 10 ml 2 times daily or 3 times daily, whether he is a driver or he is going for work or he is operating the machinery. Those conditions, you should counsel the patient. When you are driving or operating the machine, don't take that. When you are going to bed, that time you can take. When you are working, don't take, because it may cause drowsiness and sleepy. And particularly the pediatric patients, or if anyone is coming and asking any antibiotics, here it is completely prohibited. We should not dispense antibiotic to the patients whenever they are asking. It should be through prescription only, because to reduce bacterial resistance. Otherwise, they may use antibiotic here and there, then later stage, due to antibiotic resistance, the other antibiotics, it won't work. Some of the things, we have sole responsibility as a community pharmacist. We should inform to the patients in a polite manner. And even if the doctor is recommended the drug wrongly, we should call the doctor and inform to them, doctor, these are the drug interaction may happen for this patient, whatever you have prescribed. Can I change it or shall I send the patient to you? You can prescribe the medication, we can dispense. Like that also you can ask. Then apart from that, you have to explain about the, particularly the nebulizer, BP apparatus, blood glucose monitor, aerosols, particularly when the asthmatic patient, they are using aerosols. How to properly use the aerosols? We should teach, we should make counseling. For example, in my practice, one patient, the doctor prescribed erythromycin because he suffered from some upper respiratory tract infection, tonsillitis, and he has got some allergic reaction also. So doctor prescribed erythromycin along with fexofenadine. Actually, that erythromycin, it will make drug interaction with fexofenadine. It will increase the absorption of fexofenadine. What it will happen, fexofenadine dose, when the doctor is recommending 120 milligram or 180 milligram, the erythromycin, which will increase the absorption of fexofenadine, which leads to higher the dose. It may lead to increase the serum concentration. It may potentially worsening the adverse effect. So whenever the patient is coming to you, so you should always provide proper guidance and proper counseling. So it will enhance your attention towards the patient, and the patient also will respect you. So the pharmacist is guiding me a lot. So they will have good attention and good respect on your our profession.
Thank you, Prabhupada. Thank you very much. There are many things to talk with you. We definitely am planning to conduct one more webinar on the role of community pharmacies in Middle East and also career guidance related. Also, I would like to conduct one more webinar if you are free.
Sure, sure. If time permits, sure. Definitely we will make it.
Thank you, sir.
Students can ask questions if anything.
I request the participants to ask questions.
Yes, madam, we'll continue this program.
Yes, sir.
Sir,
someone yes. Is asking.
Sai Swarup.
Yes, sir. Sai Swarup, sir.
Yes.
I have a question, sir. Sir, due to varicose veins, we feel very drowsy, sir.
No, it won't make drowsy, sir. You will get only pain only. It will not make drowsy.
Not make drowsy.
It is making drowsy means it is in the cerebral, because particularly the, when you are sleeping, when you got up immediately, that time the blood flow of, will affect. It will not related to the varicose vein. Whenever you are getting up from the bed, you should not get up immediately. You should take some relax, then you should slowly wake up. What happened immediately when you wake up, the blood flow from the brain, it will make the blood flow will get speedy, or it will sometimes disturbance may happen. This may cause drowsiness. But due to varicose vein, it will not make any drowsiness.
Sir, but other complications later on, it will lead to migraine, sir, due to if any applications, blood flow is stopped to the brain, mean?
No. No, it's not due to varicose vein, it may cause migraine. Maybe it's other factors. It is not due to varicose vein, the migraine will not happen.
Okay. Only that valves will be blocked, no, sir?
Then yes, yes. That particular that valves has been, will be blocked. That backflow of the blood.
That backflow of the blood will be affecting to heart only, no, sir?
Will yes. Affect to heart. No, it's towards the vein which carries the blood towards the heart.
Yes, sir.
Particularly in the lower extremities, when the blood flow it is not coming, so automatically it may cause pain.
That is only leading to swelling and visible
swelling.
Pain will be visible, and some bluishness, numbness, some clot yes. Formation will be visible due exactly. To that only.
Yes, 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 correct, correct. Numbness, itching will be there, and you may feel heaviness in the legs. Some weight you are keeping like that, you may feel heaviness in the legs. It's all due to lack of blood supply. So automatically see, the blood will carry the oxygen. If the lack of blood flow is there, automatically the oxygen flow will stop. If the oxygen flow will stop, means automatically what it will, the lactic acid production may happen. Due to lactic acid production, that itching and irritation will happen. That's why it is causing numbness and pain. And if it is more itching, it may make ulcer also. Sometimes the vein will get more perforated. It will get burst. That capillary vessels will get burst. Then bleeding may happen, oozing out.
And in a very in that chronic insufficiency patient, that If any wound occurs, continuous bleeding will be there now, sir.
Yes, yes.
Cuff,
yes.
Let's not be cut out.
Exactly, continuous bleeding will be there, particularly from that capillaries.
Sir, in that case, when we are not unable to take the patient immediately to the hospital, how can we prevent that continuous bleeding, sir?
To prevent continuous bleeding, we can give some hemostatic agent like etamsulate or calcium dobisylate molecule we can provide for time being. But etamsulate is the immediately, it will control the bleeding. Then immediately you can rush to the healthcare professional, you can meet that healthcare professional.
Sir, it is not recommended to use Dettol and all, sir, as antiseptic.
No. That is the antiseptic, that is only just for the cleaning purpose only. It is antiseptic. This will not make any benefit towards that varicose vein. Because it's a capillary bleeding. Just we want to arrest the bleeding, and moreover, the patient is suffering from more severe pain. So if you want to reduce the pain to control the bleeding, first we can give some any NSAID along with that etamsulate or calcium dobisylate molecule. Because that etamsulate and calcium dobisylate molecule, that chemically it is the same. It's a 2,5-dihydroxybenzene sulfonate. It's a molecule. Only thing in the etamsulate, it's a diethyl ammonium salt is there, whereas the calcium dobisylate, calcium molecule is there. But that molecular structure, it is identical structure, both etamsulate as well as calcium dobisylate. So it will control the bleeding also. Even it is useful for it. That's why even hemorrhoidal bleeding, doctors were recommending even calcium dobisylate as well as etamsulate molecule.
Calcium dobisylate, sir?
Yes, calcium dobisylate. What I discussed in the last slide, that calcium dobisylate, that brand name is Doxium or Dobisil, which is available in the market, which is widely used in the market. The only thing, the calcium dobisylate during pregnancy and lactation, it is not recommended. So the patient is in pregnancy and lactation, the doctors generally, they recommend diosmin and MPF, micronized purified flavonoid fraction, along with diosmin hesperidone. The brand name is Daflon, which is also available. That is very safe drug also. And even in the pregnancy also, because pregnancy, that hemorrhoid and varicose vein, sometimes it is common. Particularly women, they are suffering a lot. So those patients, even gynecologists, they may recommend that diosmin. It is, brand name is Daflon.
Oh, so immediately they should take Daflon and they should take rest. In case of, yes, continuous bleeding.
Yes, yes, they can go. Yes, yes. It is a very safe drug because it's a flavonoid derivatives only. It will not make any major side effect. Whereas calcium dobisylate and all, better we should consult with the doctor, then only we can take.
Okay, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah, most welcome, sir.
I expect the participants have no questions, and I would like to proceed further.
Yes,
ma'am. Yes. I, Dr. Juveria Banu, on behalf of Chairman Sri SNBL Narasimha Raju Garu, Director Dr. Mal Murgan, Principal Dr. Padma M. Parak, HODs, staff and students, and on my own behalf, extend a very hearty vote of thanks to the speaker, P. Prabhakar, for gracing your important work and sharing with us your opinions today. I hope sir was successful in putting forth his ideas regarding the topic of the day, understanding the cause and management of chronic venous insufficiency. Thank you, sir. I would like to thank our chairman and director, sir, for giving us the opportunity to conduct the webinar. Thank you, sir. I would like to take this opportunity to place a hearty thanks to Dr. Padma M. Parak, Principal, the Oxford College of Pharmacy, for the perfect logistic support that she has extended all of us in organizing this webinar. Now, I would like to thank our beloved HOD, Dr. Parthasarathy ji, Department of Pharmacy Practice, for all his guidance and support for conducting this webinar. I like I thank all the HODs and the staff of the Oxford College of Pharmacy for their support. I would like to thank the whole pharmacy practice department for their support in accomplishing today's webinar successfully. Last but not the least, I would like to thank all the delegates for making this session most successful. Without you, it would not be possible. Once again, thank you all. Now I request Principal Ma'am, HOD Sir, Honorable Speaker, and all the participants to on the videos to capture the precious moments for 2 minutes. I would like everyone to on the videos. I request furthermore. I request few more participants to on your videos. Thank you, everyone. Thank you. Feedback link will be sent through mail to all registered participants, and you will be receiving an e-certificate within 1 to 3 days. Thank you, one and all. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Jyotiraya ma'am, for your wonderful support. All the participants, and thanks to Dr. Partha Sarathy, and thanks to the principal and chairman, staff members for your providing the wonderful opportunity for me, ma'am. I'm overwhelmed with your support. In future meeting, if anything is there, I will coordinate with Dr. Partha Sarathy. We'll meet once again, ma'am. Thank you very much for your support, ma'am.
Thank you,
ma'am. Take care and be safe. Have a great day, ma'am.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Partha Sarathy.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Prabhakar, for accepting our request and your very busy work schedule. You have spent your valuable time and shared your knowledge. And this is really the happiest day for me as my friend presented and very interesting topic. Many people, like many more than 160 participants, who attended this. Once again, we will meet in another session, definitely.
Thank you very much for providing the opportunity for the UN management. Have a great day.
Thank you.